Listening Library presents The Everlasting Now by Sara Harrell Banks. Read for you by Kirby Heyborne. For my brother Mike Harrell, and in loving memory of our stepfather, Edward L. Cooper, Engineer, Central of Georgia Railroad, SHB. Chapter 1. When I first met Champion Lucky, I didn't know that he was going to change my life. Maybe you never know when that's going to happen. It's not like something you're expecting. It's more like getting struck by lightning and living to tell about it. Of course, he was the one who got struck first, and I did it, but I didn't mean to. The reason I met him in the first place was because of his aunt, Lily Luther. She's a cook at our boarding house and pretty much runs everything, including me. One day, I asked Mama if we paid Lily. "Of course," she said. "Not enough," said Lily from the kitchen. "Well, if she works for us," I whispered, "how come she's the boss of everything?"
"Because she's better at it than I am," said Mama.
On the first day of summer vacation, I slept late, then went downstairs for breakfast. Lily was standing at the Roper's stove stirring a pot of black-eyed peas and listening to Sugar Blues on the radio, her skinny body swaying in time to the music.
"About time you showed up, brother," she said. "I need you to go to the dairy for buttermilk. The railroad men'll be here directly, and they'll be expecting my biscuits."
I picked up a piece of toast and started buttering it.
"Can't I eat breakfast first?"
Lily watched me with her hawk eyes. Her skin was the color of sourwood honey, not brown and not black. She wore a white flower behind one ear.
"That's enough butter," she said.
"This toast is cold. It needs more."
"Brother Sayre, put the buttered sides against your tongue. It'll taste fine. If you'd come to breakfast when you're supposed to instead of poling around wasting time, it wouldn't be cold. Hurry up now. Get 2 jars of jelly from the pantry. Scuppernong, the kind Mr. Holman likes."
That meant that I was to go swap something for something else. This time, we were going to swap jelly for buttermilk at Mr. Holman's dairy. Swapping stuff was a big thing in Snow Hill, Alabama in 1937. We were in the Great Depression, although there was nothing great about it. Songs were written about it and how everybody was suffering. Mama's always singing about hard times, railroads, and lonesome valleys. Lily just sings the blues. Seems like hard times happened to everybody. The stock market crashed, so a lot of people lost all their money. Then there was a run on the banks, and folks that had money took it out of the banks. A terrible dust storm in Oklahoma and Kansas ruined the crops in the fields, so farmers had to leave their farms and go to California to find work. Some did, some didn't. Here in Snow Hill, the mercantile bank closed, the shirt factory shut down, men got laid off at the sawmill, and some stores had to close because there wasn't any business. About the only real business that was still working was the railroad. My daddy was the editor and publisher of the town's only newspaper, the Choctaw Herald, and it had to shut down. He explained that since folks couldn't afford to advertise in the paper, he couldn't afford to print it. He also said that a town without a newspaper was a poor town indeed. After he closed the newspaper office, he left home to look for work. And that's when the worst thing of all happened to our family. Daddy went to North Carolina to apply for a job at a big paper. But when he got there, the people who worked for the paper, the journalists, reporters, and linotype operators, went on strike against the paper. Well, being a newspaper man, Daddy couldn't cross the picket lines. Then, delivery trucks rolled up, and instead of picking up papers, men got out of the trucks and started beating the strikers.
That's when Daddy got killed. He was just trying to help, but I guess they got him mixed up with the strikers, and somebody hit him in the head with a tire iron. That was 2 years ago. We all miss him something awful. My mama, my sister Swan, and I live in Grandpapa Yateman's big old house that he'd left to Mama when he died. Because of the Depression, we didn't have much money, and there weren't many jobs in Snow Hill. But we have to make a living, said Mama. Only I can't get a job around here. It's hard enough for men to find jobs. Besides, I don't know how to do anything but keep house. You can do lots of things, I said. You're a good reader and a pretty good cook, and you grow stuff, too. Nothing I could get paid for, she said. But thank you anyway. We'll think of something. She started walking through the house like she was looking for something. I followed her upstairs. She went into each of the 5 bedrooms and even into the trunk room that belongs to my little sister. Then we went through all the rooms downstairs. And when she finished the tour, Mama stood there looking up at the picture of Grandpapa Yateman in his black judge's robe hanging over the mantel. Your grandpapa left me this house to do with as I please, she told me, and he'd have wanted us to survive these hard times. In fact, he'd have expected us to survive. So she decided to open a boarding house for nice people. Some people in town didn't think she should, since she was the judge's daughter and it didn't look proper. They acted like it was their house instead of ours. But Mama paid them no mind. She just went about her business. And that's when Lily came to work for us and started to run our lives. Lily took the pot of peas off the stove and, putting her hands on her hips, gave me her hawk look. Brother Sayre, she said, stop daydreaming and get about your business. A railroad calendar hung on the inside of the pantry door. On it was a picture of the 20th Century Limited, the most beautiful steam engine in the world, rounding a curve of track like she's riding to glory. Mr. Edwards, who's one of our boarders and a railroad engineer, had given it to me. Homemade jellies, preserves, fruits, and vegetables lined the shelves from top to bottom. We grew most of what we ate. Every season, Mama and Lily put up peaches, tomatoes, applesauce, beans, watermelon pickles, and just about anything else that grew in the garden. I took down 2 jars of golden scuppernong jelly and patted the calendar on my way out. Lily, I said, putting the jelly jars into a paper sack, reckon how long this depression's gonna last? Don't be asking me about the depression, she said. It don't mean much to me. Don't mean much to any Negroes. We was born in depression. It only became official when it hit the whites. Now, before you go, run on and see does your mama want anything from town. I went upstairs to the sewing room. I heard Mama before I saw her. She was singing about trains, keeping time with her foot on the treadle of the sewing machine. This train is bound for glory. This train, thump, thump, thump. Mama was mending sheets. She'd split them down the middle where they were worn, turn the outside edges to the inside, then make a new seam. Keeping a boarding house takes a lot of sheets. She looked up when I came in. She was wearing one of Daddy's old shirts and trousers rolled at the ankles. Her curly brown hair was piled on top of her head. Lily says, do you need anything from town? Just the mail, she said. And I'd like for you to stop by the library. Miss Eulalie has a book for me. Downstairs, in the shadowy hall, a man's hat hung on the hall tree. It's my daddy's best hat, a dark brown Dunlop felt with a kind of silky hatband. After his funeral, the preacher said I'd have to be the man of the house. That was a joke. I was only 10 when Daddy died, but that's when I claimed the hat for my own. It was too big, but I started wearing it anyway, hoping it'd make me look older. I'm almost 12 now, and I still don't look like the man of any house. I'm skinny, there's a gap between my front teeth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.